The following presentation is rated WPC.
My name is William Patrick. Welcome to Filmbuff. Welcome to Filmbuff.
The following presentation is rated WPC.
You want to know who Fred Kruger was? He was a filthy child murderer who killed at least 20 kids in the neighborhood. Kids we all knew. It drove us crazy when we didn't know who it was. But it was even worse after they caught him.
What did you do, Mother?
A bunch of us parents tracked him down after they let him out. We found him in an old abandoned boiler room where he used to take his kids. Took gasoline, poured it all around the place. Let the whole thing up and watched it burn. But he can't get you now. He's dead, honey, because Mommy killed him.
Please, God.
This is God. Sing for the laugh and sing for the tear. Sing a window just for today. Maybe tomorrow the good Lord will take you away.
Song from Fresh Prince and DJ Jazzy Jeff. Fresh Prince is Will Smith. Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Yeah, they did a song called Nightmare on My Street. Same album that they had, Parents Just Don't Understand. Great fucking song. No, I'm serious. It's a great fucking song. It's not associated with the movie at all. Something about rights, but hey guys, welcome back to Filmbuff University here on Filmbuff. I'm your host, William Patrick Coleman, and you just saw that awesomely new structured trailer edited by moi. The subject of today's topic on the show is none other than A Nightmare on Elm Street. The original, not to be confused with the 2010 remake, but the 1984 psychological horror movie. One of the first to coin the term the slasher flick from late great director Wes Craven, who some would consider to be the master of horror. And although Nightmare was not his first foray into the genre, having The Hills Have Eyes under his belt, it certainly would not be his last either. Scream. Scream 2. Scream 3. Scream 4. What was that? As in all slasher flicks, you need to have a compelling antagonist. Someone interesting, yet terrifying, all at once. How could you possibly top Jason Voorhees, or the big Frankenstein that is Michael Myers? Well, Wes Craven seemed to have the perfect answer to that. His name was Freddy Kruger, and he's portrayed with just the right and appropriate amount of overacting by legendary performer Robert Englund, a role that was being prepped for theater actor David Warner. Originally, history would explain Freddy was a gleeful child murderer without remorse, linked to a large unsolved list of names for missing children, who would fall prey to the kids' parents and mourners of the slain after they gathered to corner Freddy one night. Once he was released from authorities and evidence couldn't detain him legally, they united with community justice in order to burn him alive in the very own broiler where many suspected he got rid of his victims and watched them burn. A Nightmare on Elm Street is the story that expresses his legacy, complete with horrific burnt flesh disfigurement hidden amongst the dreams and nightmares of future teenage children, the offspring of his murderous mob. Nancy, played by actress Heather Langenkamp, is basically the leader of a group of four teens living in the same vicinity of the neighborhood on Elm Street. One by one, they find themselves facing the dark figure hidden in the shadows under his brown fedora and tattered ripped green and red striped sweater, equipped with a self-created personal weapon of choice, a workman's brown glove with installed long razor knife blades fashioned like fingernails for his right hand. An appropriate sort of weapon one could raise above their heads high in the air and control enough fear into the gullible and terrified teens. Some began to die in their sleep. Others would be able to bring the terror with them in an effort to escape, only to fall prey regardless. No evidence, no trace, and no escape whatsoever. Conveniently for us, Nancy's father, a founding mob member, also happens to be the sheriff of their community, and he's played by John, I'm so cool, I sound like I'm being 80-yard all the time, Saxon.
Terrific. What the hell was she doing there?
She lived there.
I don't mean her. I mean you. What was she doing there?
It seems like no movie article on the subject can speak about the movie without mentioning it being Johnny Depp's first introduction into cinema. And to be honest, his career had become so much more impressive so fast afterwards that this might be literally the least exciting role he's ever played. Because the character required somebody who was such a non-threat as Nancy's boyfriend. Matter of fact, it's his wicked death scene where his bed swallows him whole and then proceeds to vomit his remains into the sky of his bedroom that's much more memorable than he is. And it remains one of the coolest death scenes amongst its 8 installments history. It's even much more interesting to mention actress Lynn Shay of Insidious and There's Something About Mary fame as a school teacher. But it would make sense to see her eventually in one of New Line Cinema founder and producer Robert Shay's work. Sooner or later, she's his sister. Maybe Charles Fleischer as the doctor could be worth mentioning. But unfortunately, I've never seen this character actor used to his talents more properly except for the voice of Roger Rabbit from Who Framed Roger Rabbit, which would come out 4 years later after this release. You know, I never even noticed until now that Joseph Whipp, who plays the town's deputy, would make an appearance as the actual sheriff in Wes Craven and Kevin Williamson's Scream.
Wow.
But listen, if there's anybody worth mentioning or bragging or gloating about, it's the honest and sincere performance from actress Renee Blakely as Nancy's mother, leaving me speechless as I walk away from scenes like this.
I've got something better. I'm going to get her some help.
Or performances like this.
You didn't sleep at all last night, did you? You know, the doctor says you have to sleep or
I'll go even crazier.
I don't think you're crazy. And stop drinking that damn coffee.
Or acting choices like that.
You face things. That's your nature. That's your gift. But sometime you have to turn away, too.
Or commitment like this.
It's gonna burn off sooner. It wouldn't be so bright.
Feeling better?
Oh, I feel like $1,000,000. They say you've bottomed out when you can't remember the night before. No, baby, I'm gonna stop drinking. I just don't feel like it anymore.
Did she win an Oscar? She didn't want an Oscar for that, didn't she? She won an Oscar for that role? Don't give it to Ellen Burstyn for The Exorcist, but give it to Renee Blakely for Nightmare on Elm Street. Usually a horror movie villain or icon will be based on one character who gave the creator an inspired idea to take something that was truly horrific in real life and add somewhat of an adrenaline shot to the concept. Even placing a mask on his face often, but not with Freddy. The concept of being trapped within your own dreams and your own conscience is actually based on 5 different things as Wes Craven leaned on while writing the script. In the 1970s, an article explained a couple of mysterious cases involving refugees who fled war from Cambodia to arrive in the USA, and some would have nightmares so intense that they died in their sleep. Although the press declined from writing it publicly and nationwide, and the amount of victims were so rare and uncommon, it was peculiar enough for medical professionals to refer to it as Asian Death Syndrome. The image of Kruger derives from Craven's childhood itself as one day, little Wes was admiring the nighttime air when suddenly he spotted a man lurking in the alleyway of the shadows, walking from him. Then silent alert rang when, for seemingly no reason whatsoever at all, he stopped and turned slowly to notice Wes directly above him, before smiling and continuing to shuffle off. Although nothing came from the incident itself, it certainly left an impression on little Wes. As did an interaction with a school bully Wes particularly had altercations with, by the name of Fred Kruger. Now, this would be the second time that Craven would recycle the name for a character in his work, after he shortened it as Krug for the villain of The Last House on the Left. The two colors on Kruger's sweater was no accident either, as Wes read an informative article in Scientific American in 1982 that said the red and green colors were the most clashing colors to the human retina. Another not-so-confirmed source claims that he also lifted another concept from a student he taught at Clarkston University in 1968, who turned in a school project parodying horror films shot on the residential neighborhood of Elm Street. Being a child of the 80s, I certainly embraced a director or creator's usage of practical effects with their storytelling before the world of digital came in separating how movies would even be financed to how stories would be told. I am one of those people who think that the xenomorph alien from the Aliens franchise is a lot scarier in the dark as a puppet than a digital version in the light running around on its hind legs. There's no doubt that part of what makes Wes Craven such a genius director in his appropriate use of practical effects in support of his brilliant idea for a movie monster who exists in the deepest, darkest conscience of your mind, a place you can easily wander into but struggle to find your way out of. But one can't help but wonder that this idea might be bigger and deserve more effects-driven attention than that. Sure, a good director knows all about presentation when it comes down to it, like a good magician pulling off the perfect trick. You're dying to know how he pulled it off, but just because he didn't have access to it doesn't mean that the same smart director couldn't have elevated this idea more. In the heart of the 80s is where this monster will forever be born, amongst shoulder to shoulders with Darth Vader and Jack Nicholson's Joker as the best villain in film. But had we come across this concept way late and matched with our technology at the discovery point in film history as, say, The Matrix, could we possibly be looking at, dare I say, a better movie with a better cast and better effects that supported such a creative runaway mind like Craven's? One will never know. That's so weird and so bizarre. I'll tell you what's not weird and bizarre. Our In the Field segment with Ryan Miller. Completely normal. Let's see what boring, normal adventures he's going on today. Ryan?
Dogs. Hello, Earthling. We're glad you found your Mud Dog's hat. Because, like you, we too are massive fans of the Adam Sandler film, The Waterboy. The Waterboy makes clear the importance of water, more specifically, the importance of high-quality H2O. Like humans, we are carbon-based beings that depend on high-quality H2O to survive. But as you can see around you, our planet is nearly devoid of any water. It's kind of like the main planet in Dune. Can't wait to see what Villeneuve does with that IP. Anyways, we brought you up here because we need your help. We need high-quality H2O. We need water. We are asking that you deliver us 2 liters of purified water once a week. You can get here via phone booth or payphone by dialing 1-877-CARS-FOR-KIDS, K-A-R-S, CARS for Kids. 1-877-CARS-FOR-KIDS, donate your car today. If you decline our request, we will attack and colonize Earth, stealing the abundance of high-quality H2O in the process. The choice is yours. Please check the box below for what you decide, and leave the letter where you found it. Thanks. The aliens. I gotta find a payphone or a phone booth once a week? That's a pain in the butt. I had to drive really far to find the last one. But no alien should die because he doesn't have water. Feels good to get the old mud dog's hat back. Wait, how do I get back to Earth? Had a nightmare. Kind of like how the characters have nightmares and Nightmare in Elm Street. I got my Mud Dog's hat back. Alright, I gotta get some sleep. Back to you, Will.
I'm sure I don't need to take the time during this specific review to mention the unfortunate future of its franchise, but I will. With sequel after sequel being released every 2 years or so, with its only consistency being its original performer, Robert Englund, who plays Freddy, more and more like a late-night Saturday horror movie of the week host, spoofing upon a once terrifying cinematic boogeyman that he, ironically, helped create originally, himself. And it's no coincidence that in the mid-80s they would expand more lucratively by releasing the show Freddy's Nightmares, in which every episode that he hosted week by week featured a new character trapped in their own prison of dreams, waiting to be haunted by Freddy. Each sequel installment is connected to its own fair share of controversy, with Part 2 once being hailed as the most secretly homosexually implied horror movie of all time. Part 3, titled The Dream Warriors, could arguably be one of the best second sequel and third installments ever made, with a lot of its fans feeling that it's just as good, if not better, than the original, which also features Heather Langenkamp and up-and-coming stars Oscar winner Patricia Arquette and Lawrence Fishburne. Then it's pretty much down, down, downhill from there, with Part 4 of The Dream Master, Part 5 of The Dream Child, and the fantastically marketed but ultimately disappointing 6th chapter titled Freddy's Dead, the return of Wes Craven for New Nightmare. This one being the most original and fun approach to Freddy, with its meta concept leaving him to chase Wes, Heather, and producer Robert Shea themselves, playing versions of themselves. A movie that feels heavy with studio meddling and more of a loss on what could have been, followed by the fan-favorite spin-off mashup of Freddy vs. Jason, in which Kruger is comically facing off against Camp Crystal Lake's very own menacing horror icon, Jason Voorhees. Then, as I mentioned earlier, 2010 saw the remake of Nightmare on Elm Street, replacing Englund as Freddy Kruger with Oscar-nominated Jackie Earle Haley, an actor who was amongst the list of names originally in the running for the character Glenn back in 1984 before he passed the role off to his friend, better suited for the role, Johnny Depp. Observing the failure of this remake brings to light why the original works so well, and it's not the special effects. It's the construction of Freddy himself. Hidden under much more realistic makeup as a burn victim, Haley's Freddy is changed to a child molester in replacement of a child killer, while providing even less evidence of his crimes to the neighborhood parents of the victims. It's much more unsettling, and not in a good way, when Freddy makes his inappropriate jokes based on more current-themed sins.
Did you know that after the heart stops beating, the brain keeps functioning for well over 7 minutes? We got 6 more minutes to play.
The result is him becoming something worse than a horror movie villain. He becomes a reflection of the most horrific and destructive representation for a crumbling mind, far from sanity, and a sick individual who needs help. After watching somebody else play Freddy, not only do you appreciate the original's portrayal, but you realize that it was a perfect blending of England's overperformance and Craven's carefully crafted, under-orchestrated presentation. Stars that have never been aligned so perfect in the horror movie universe that allow Freddy to be haunting, disturbing, terrifying, and still acceptably entertaining. Over time, I still feel it's one of the most creative and original horror movies ever made. While it might be suffering as one of the very few movies in the world that exists and could have benefited from a decade or two worth of special effects technology in order to better support these worlds without walls. We're going to go ahead and give Nightmare on Elm Street a B-. They just don't make movies like this anymore, and nor could they. That's all the time we have for today. I'm William Patrick Coleman. This is Film Buff University.
1, 2, Freddy's coming for you. 3, 4, better luck.
Where's your past? Screw your past.
Let's go.